together.
Oh, I'll be set free. I'll be set free.
one last time by the blood. Here we go. By the hallelujah. Give God glory.
Amen. Greetings, saints, in the name of the Lord. This morning, we are excited to come to you from the Let's Go to Glory Worship Center Sanctuary, Eswatini, Ezulwini. We have come to share the word of God with you. And before we begin, I would like us to start with the word of prayer. Today, we will speak about the omnipotence of God in terms of, we know, everyone knows that when we speak about the omnipotence of God, we are speaking about the all-powerful God. So let's start with the word of prayer. Father, we thank you that you are God, and besides you, there's no other God. We thank you, Lord, that you have allowed us to come and dwell, Lord, on this earth. And Father, you have given us the same power that you have released upon us on the earth to be able to influence and restore your people back to their position. Father, we thank you that the omnipotent power of God will work wonders even as we are receiving the word of God this morning. We believe you and we trust you in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise the Lord. Last week we spoke we were speaking about the issue that the Lord is actually breaking the walls of the church. And we spoke specifically about people that are going to be moving from one floor to the next, seeking for the depth and the power of God in their time. And this morning we want to also go back and speak about the all-powerful God whom we serve. And we've got evidence this morning of the power of God that is actually at work in our lives. We can testify as Let's Go to Glory Worship Center about the power of God that we see at work in our lives. Now, I want us to then speak about the vision John the Revelator, when he heard the voice of a great multitude, and as the voice of many waters and the voice of mighty thundering surrounding throughout the universe. And what the voice proclaimed was the sovereignty and omnipotence of God. He said, hallelujah, for the Lord God omnipotent reigneth. Now, the element of sovereignty and omnipotence, it goes together. When you speak about God, it cannot exist without the other. To reign, God must have power. And to reign, he needs sovereignty. He must have all the power. And that is what omnipotent means. It means having all the power. The word derives from the Latin and is identical in the meaning with the more familiar Almighty, which we have always been speaking about, that we speak about the Almighty God, the all-powerful God. He has all the potency. He has all the power. God possesses what no creature can have, an incomprehensible plenitude of power. And a potency that is absolute, which means God is the only person and the only existing God who carries with him the potent, and he carries all the power that you can ever think about. And I like the use of the word absolute by one of my favorite writers, A.W. Tozer. He says he has absolute power. It means there is no other person who has the same power that he has. He is absolute. He has all the power in the world. And we have realized as we are living and doing all that we are doing, and we have seen that God continuously demonstrates his potency by the things that he does. This we know by divine revelation. But once it is known, it is recognized as being in full accord with reason. Grant that God is infinite and self-existent, and we see at once that he must be all-powerful as well. Now, when we speak about that God has all the power and has all the power that he possesses, it then means if God has so much power and has absolute power, it then means to us he must be the all-powerful God And that's the reason why we kneel to worship before him. We are worshiping before the omnipotent power of God. Power belongs to God, says the psalmist. And Paul the apostle declares that nature itself gives evidence of the eternal power of the Godhead. That's Romans chapter 1, verse number 20. From this knowledge, we reason to the omnipotence of God this way. God has power. Since God is also infinite, whatever he has must be without limit. Therefore, God has limitless power. He is omnipotent. And this made me excited because when you read the scriptures, every time we speak about the power of God, we refer outside. But the Bible speaks that the same power that God has, he has given it to us. He speaks, the Bible says, a greater things shall you do in my name. So which means we possess in us a limitless power ourselves that makes us to become now like God in the utilization of power. This week we were speaking about the all-powerful God with the Apostle Manana, and we were speaking about how much power God has. And some of us were speaking about how we don't see the demonstrable power of God in our time. Because when we speak about the power of God, we speak about things that we see flying all over the place, things popping out, and we think that's what power is. And we limit that power to those things. And it is important for us to then understand that when we speak about the power of God, we speak about God having limitless power, which means the power of God cannot end. We see further that God, the self-existent creator, is the source of all the power there is. And since a source must be at least equal to anything that emanates from it, God is of necessity equal to all the powers there is. And this to say again that he is omnipotent. Now, this is very important. When you look at an appliance that is plugged on the wall through electricity, if it does not have the capacity to carry the power that comes out of the source of electricity, it will die. It will collapse. It will not be able to function. Actually, it will burn and it will not be recognizable. And the house will trip because the power that comes from the socket cannot be contained by the power, by the recipient of the power. So which means, therefore, if God has the power and we say we have received the power of God, it means we have in us the capacity and the ability to carry this power of God, because ngeke it 240 volts, it cannot go into something less than it. Otherwise, it will not be able to function. Our functionality, therefore, means we function in us with the power of God. We function in us carrying the power of God. And God has allowed the very same power that he has, and he has given it to us. And we are actually operating in the power of God. God has delegated power to us as people of God. But being self-sufficient, he cannot relinquish anything of his perfections, and power being one of them. He has never surrendered at least an iota of what he carries. He gives, but he does not give away. So God gives us power, but he doesn't lose anything by giving it to us. All that he gives remains his own and returns to him again forever. He must remain what he has forever been, the Lord God omnipotent. And I want to explain this. It's very important for us to explain. Because when we speak about that we carry the same power that God carries, it means that we can function at the same level in which God functions. And every time we say that, Christians fight with us. When we say that, they say we are fanatic. When we say that, they say we are now preaching an erroneous gospel. But I want to present to you this morning that when God gave us the power, he gave us the same power. He didn't give us part of the power. He gave us the same power that he carries. And when the Bible speaks about us, when Jesus rose from the dead, he rose again. And when he rose again, he took the keys of the kingdom and he gave us the authority. So which means the omnipotency of God can also be seen through the actions that we do as people of God on earth. We can exist in the realm of God. I know the prophet would say, as long as the earth It says, as far as the heavens are from the earth. That's the right one. As far as the heavens are from the earth, so are my ways and so are my thoughts. And we came to a point where we thought, like, if that the Bible says that, it means then we cannot think the thoughts of God. And we then said we cannot live in the ways of God because of what the prophets proclaimed. But when the Apostle Paul wrote, he said, in him we live, we move, and we find our being. Which means we, if we are in God, we carry a potent power that comes from God. We carry that same power to be able to use it to facilitate the restoration of men back to God. God is an omnipotent God, but God has given us the power, because we cannot be able to carry the power of God if God has not given us the capacity to receive it. So it's very important for us to understand that God gives, but it does not give away. When he gives us the power, it doesn't mean he then loses the power that he has. All that he gives remains his own and returns to him again. So when we function in the power of God, therefore we are not functioning in our own power, but we are functioning in the power of God, which God has given to us. So forever he must remain what he has forever been, the Lord God omnipotent. And it's very important for us to then emphasize again that one cannot long read the scriptures sympathetically without noticing the radical disparity between the outlook of men of the Bible and that of modern men. We are today suffering from a secularized mentality where the sacred writers saw God, we saw the laws of nature. Their world was fully populated. Our world is all but empty. Their world was alive and personal. Ours is impersonal and dead. And I will explain this because I'm quoting from some of the writings of A.W. Tozer. He's saying the element of us thinking about God, we think about God from a perspective that we cannot reach him. He's far away. We cannot function as the way that he functions. We cannot operate in the realm that God is operating. But God has given us that we should have a relationship with us. God rules our world. And ours is ruled by the laws of nature. And we are always once removed from the presence of God. And when the Bible speaks in the book of Genesis, it speaks about very something peculiar. It speaks about a time when God in the cool of the day would visit with men. And when he visited with men, and I always imagine that visitation, it was a visitation between God the king and God and Adamu or Adam, who was God of human beings. God gave the power to rule the earth, and he gave it to us. He gave us the authority to rule the earth, and we are functioning now not just with the power from God, but we are functioning with the power of God, because God gives but does not give away. The fact that he gave us the power to operate, it doesn't mean that in his storehouse there is less. Let me make an example. When SEC or EEC gives us power, through our gadgets in our houses, it doesn't mean that EEC then doesn't have power because they gave to us. They still possess the power, but we are utilizing the power of EEC to be able to function. So the same thing applies with our relationship with God. We are functioning on earth. We are functioning through the power of God, and we are drawing from the omnipotency of God, and we are going to be able to function in this world by using that power. But how do we experience this power? We can only be able to enjoy and experience it if we stay connected to the source. If we disconnect from the source, then we are not going to function. If we don't have a relationship with him, then we're not going to function completely. Will function not the way that we are supposed to function. And I love the illustration that God has so much power. God has omnipotent power. Now, when it speaks about potency, it would mean to me in science, it's stored. But the power that God possesses is stored. It can only function if someone picks it up from God and uses it so that they can change their situation. That's why we go to a place of prayer and we begin to pray. And when we pray to God, we are tapping into the source of power. We are tapping into the power that God has given to us. And we are able to function because we are now connected to the source. It's important for us to stay connected to the source. And if we stay connected to the source, then we are going to be able to function. Religion says, on the other hand, goes back to the nature of God. It is concerned with the footprints a God along the paths of creation, but with one who treads those paths. Now, I want to illustrate a point. I was reading in the scriptures, and I want to quote it precisely because I think I still have it somewhere. I was reading about the time when they reported to Jesus about the death of Lazarus. They tell him, Lazarus, your friend, is dead. They send a messenger. And Jesus says, this sickness is, when they speak about his sickness, this sickness is not unto death. And then they come back and report to him that Lazarus is actually dead. And still he maintains that he's not dead, but he's asleep. And when he gets to the place of prayer, the day that is asked, the Bible says, he said, take me to where have you put him? They show him where he has been put. And the Bible says, he then made a prayer. And that prayer has always made me marvel and wonder. He made a prayer and said, Lord, you have heard me. And the question is, when did you hear me? He speaks about the relationship that he has with God. And he says, I am doing this for these that are watching. Otherwise, I understand the relationship I have with you, which means I understand the power and the potency that you have as God to be able to release or to raise this man from the dead. And the Bible says, he said, roll the stone away. And when they rolled the stone away, he called on Lazarus. And he said, Lazarus, Lazarus, come forth. And Lazarus came forth. And the Bible says he still had the bandages. And he said, untie him. And this makes me understand that Jesus was operating in the power of God. He was operating in the omnipresence of God. And he was able to raise Lazarus based on the relationship that he has with God. I want you to understand that whatever that we are speaking about, we need to understand that the element of omnipotence of God, for it to function and work for us, we need to have a relationship with God. We need to have a relationship with God. When we started, we spoke and said, God has absolute power, which means he is the only one who has the power. He is the only one who has the ability. So omnipotence is not a name given to the sum of all the power, but an attribute of a personal God we Christians believe to be the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, and all who believe in him to life eternal. Very important. Omnipotence is not the name of God, but it is a character of God or an attribute of God, which we as children of God still, we also carry it, and we can use the power of God that God has, that God carries, that God has given to us. The Bible says we carry in us a life-giving spirit of God. And if you can give life, it means you have got potent power. You've got powerful power that is the same as God has. So what am I saying? I'm saying it will operate in your life if you use it at a personal level. If you use it together with a relationship with God, it will work not as a magic wand, but it will work because you have a relationship with God. You are connected to God. You are connected to the source. Otherwise, if you are not connected to God, it becomes magic. And God does not work in magic, but God works in power. So the worshiping man finds this knowledge a source of wonderful strength for his inner life. His faith rises to take the great leap upward into the fellowship of him who can do whatever he wills to do, for whom nothing is hard or difficult, because he possesses a power that is absolute. He spoke in the book of Luke chapter number 1, verse number 37. He said, for there's nothing impossible with our God, which means I possess an absolute power. I possess a monopoly to the power as God, that I can do whatever I want to do because I am God. I can defy science. I can defy logic. I can defy the stars of the earth. I can defy all things that are happening because I am God. I carry in me a potent power. I am God. So when Luke said, there's nothing impossible with our God, I read the scripture and I marveled, and I read before he said that. I saw that he could actually make sure that from a virgin, there would come a son. And from a virgin, there would come the savior of the world. And he made sure that from an old woman called Elizabeth, he would actually be able to release a John. And John will become the precursor for the coming of Jesus. He says, for there's nothing impossible with me as God. He's an omnipotent God. And he goes to an old man who is Abraham. And he goes to Sarah, who is old and who even laughs and thinks she can never have children. He goes to her and says, you shall have a son. And you actually, your inheritance will be eaten by the son of the promise. And he gives her a child. Do you understand what I am saying? I am saying God carries in him an absolute power. But the power that he carries, he has allowed us as a church to tap into it. He has allowed us as a church to be connected to him so that we can be able to use that power, the omnipotent power of God. I want to bring it to a close. So since he has at his command all the power in the universe, the Lord God omnipotent can do anything as easily as anything else. All his acts are done without effort. He expends no energy that must be replenished. Which means when he does, he doesn't need to be charged again so he can have the power. He doesn't need to be charged again to replace what he has used. God has all the power. He has all the power in the world. He carries the power. All his acts are done without effort. I marvel at people that will testify and say, I had gone to this doctor. I had spoken to this prophet. I had spoken to this person and I didn't get the help. But when I went to God, at the click of a button, I was saved and I was healed. Which means God does things without any effort. We are the ones that put effort to things, but God expends no energy that must be replenished. He's self-sufficient. He makes it unnecessary for him to look outside of himself. Those are the words of A.W. Tozer. I love them. He says he's self-sufficient. He makes it unnecessary for him to look outside of himself for a renewal of strength. We as Christians, we always sing songs, renew our strength. We sing songs, don't take it away. We sing songs because we speak from a place of carnality where we are disconnected with God. But if we would always be connected to God, all the power required to do all that he wills to do lies in undiminished fullness in his own infinite being. I love these words. It says, simply says, if we stay connected to God, we will be connected to God and actually be able to do the things that God wants to be done on earth. Let me make an example. God puts us in politics. When we get into politics, we don't talk politics based on our philosophy of politics, but we speak politics on the philosophy of God concerning politics, and we stay connected to God. When there's a resolution that's supposed to be made, we ask God and say, Lord, I do not know, but you know. We are totally reliant on God. And since he has at his command, all the power in the Lord omnipotent can do anything as easily as anything else. We rely on God. When we need money, every time the first thought that we have, let me go and check the bank. When we need money, the first thought that comes in, let me go and see a Shylock. When we need money, the first thing we think about my cousin, my brother who has got money. But God is simply saying with this message, when I am in need, the first preference, I need to connect to the source and say, God, you know that I need resources for this. Lord, come through for me. He's the supplier of all needs. He's self-sufficient. In Siswati, akadzingi lutho lwemuntu. When we think that we can do things for God, we are in denial of the power of God. God can do things for himself. We are standing here this morning under the roof of a building that God has built himself. We have a testimony that when God says, I won't build it with your money, I will build it myself, he knows what he's speaking about. And that is what we are experiencing. And I want you to understand that all the power required to do all that needs to be done is in you also. And I know it always drives Christians bananas when you say they've got power. They always think that we don't have. We should ask somewhere. But I always say, connect to the source. That's where the power is. And they say, but where are the miracles? And God says, but you are a miracle worker. You can perform the miracles if you are connected to me as God. Because I am a miracle worker. I never make a promise and don't fulfill it. Whenever he speaks, my favorite text, some person was saying to me, why is it that every time you preach, you've got a favorite text? I always say, everything seems to be my favorite. I love the word that says, God will never speak a word. And then it returns to him void. Without accomplishing what it has been sent out to do. Because God will protect his word. God will defend his word. God will ensure that there is supply necessary for the word to be fulfilled. If God has spoken, if it is him that has spoken, God doesn't want to be embarrassed that he said something and it didn't happen. When he proclaimed to Abraham and Sarah that you shall have a child, and they laughed, and Sarah laughed because he looked at her condition. She did not understand that God does not fail. When he speaks something, he's going to do it. It doesn't matter how long it takes, but because God has declared it, it must come to pass. And it will come to pass. We need to understand that God, whenever he speaks, nothing is too hard for him. No man can work like him. I know as preachers and as children of God, we think we can work at the same level with him. But when God has made a promise, the Bible says in Romans 8:14, for as many as they are led by the Spirit, they are the sons of God. They are the sons of God. I was imagining on Wednesday when they went through the gates, beautiful, and they went in, they found a man who was begging for alms. And he said, he was begging for them. They said, silver and gold have we none. And they said something very peculiar. And they said, such as we have, we give to you. And as children of God, every time we don't have money, we don't have transport, we don't have anything else, but there's something that is never taken away from us. It is the power of God. They said to such as we have, we give unto you. And they said, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. What were they doing? They were saying, I may not have all other things, but there's something that cannot be taken away from me, which is the omnipotent power of God. It stays with us. Let me close it. Now, it's important that we think as a church and as a body, and as you are listening or watching this broadcast, that if God says he carries all the power and he has a monopoly of absolutism where power is concerned, there's no other way but to stick to God and nothing else. There's no other way but to always be connected to God because he carries all the power. If he says, I have the absolute power, it would mean everyone should be running to him and rushing and saying, I want to stay connected because this is the person that carries the power, right? And people say, but we don't see it. But you can never see it unless it works. A man of God said, how for you to know that the power is in operation, plug it up, switch it on. When you switch it on, the lights will come on and you will say, oh, there's power. Power is at work. When you switch your kettle on and you're trying to boil some water, you will hear a sound and you will know that the power is in operation. God is the all-knowing, omnipotent God, and he's a sovereign God, and he carries all the authority and all the power that we need. Let us not be deceived. We cannot get power from human beings. We cannot get power from our prophets. We cannot get power from witch doctors. We cannot get power from Bapolofiti. We cannot get power from all sorts of sources. God carries that. Even the ability for that prophet or that witch doctor for them to actually exist is based on the ability of the potency of God. They are alive because of God. They don't carry life, but God carries life. You are blessed as a child of God because you carry in you a life-giving spirit of God. But when do you give life? You give life when God directs you to give life, because God is the one that is a giver of all good gifts. He's the one where there's no shadow of turning with him. He's the one that gives you power. So when voices come and compete with you and say, but where is your God? But where is your what? Always make them remember that the Bible says, I have the power to to nullify and quieten every voice that competes against what God has said. And we choose to believe in the omnipotent power of the Spirit and of God. I am praying, and it's very important for us to understand that a God has our best interests at heart. And that when he carries the power that he carries, I want to repeat something that I said earlier, that a God, when he gives us the power, he doesn't give it away. It remains with him. All that he gives remains his own and returns to him again. Forever he must remain what he has forever been, the Lord God omnipotent, our God, our Father, and our King. Let us pray. Father, we thank you that, Father, you have allowed us to understand and to appreciate that you are an omnipotent God. And that, Father, for us to be able to see the potency of this power, we need to be connected to you. Father, we need to stay connected to you for us to see the change in the world. If every child of God will be connected to the source, then we'll be able to walk in the ways of God. We'll be able to think the thoughts of God. And we'll be walking in the ways of God, just like the Apostle Paul said, in him we live, we move, and we find our being. Father, we pray as the week begins, Lord, give us the grace, give us the ability, God, to be able to walk in the ways of God. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Praise the Lord.
Jehovah, O kahle, O kahle, Jehovah, O kahle. Jehovah o kahle, o kahle, Jehovah o kahle, Jehovah. Why you chavele? Shangwini wangene lena wena ukase Yehova ukase watsembeka kimasi.